मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टूडेज टॉपिक इज एग्रीगेट डिमांड, एग्रीगेट सप्लाई एंड रिलेटेड कंसेप्ट्स। सो फर्स्ट वन इज कंसेप्ट ऑफ एग्रीगेट डिमांड। एज वी नो, एग्रीगेट डिमांड रेफर्स टू द डिमांड ऑफ ऑल गुड्स एंड सर्विसेज इन द इकोनमी। सो बिफोर वी स्टार्ट एग्रीगेट डिमांड इन मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स, there are certain observations which need to be noted to understand the concept of aggregate demand. First one is, aggregate demand does not refers to the demand for any particular commodity. Instead, it refers to demand for all goods and services in the economy. Second one is, aggregate demand is measured for the period of an accounting year. So it is a flow concept. Aggregate demand is measured with reference to general price level in the economy and with reference to level of income in the economy. When aggregate demand is studied in relation to general price level, then there is a negative relationship between price and demand. Means with increase in price, demand decreases, and with decrease in price, demand increases. But in case of aggregate demand with relation to income, there is positive relationship between demand will also increases with increase in income, and it decreases with decrease in income. Aggregate demand is measured in term of total expenditure on the goods and services. It will not be measured in term of total physical quantities of goods demanded in the economy. And the last one is, aggregate demand is always expressed at what people wish to spend or what people plan to spend at different levels of income. So these were the some of the observations which are needed to be understand the concept of aggregate demand. So next is behavior of aggregate demand, that is aggregate schedule. Behavior of aggregate demand means how aggregate expenditure responds to different levels of income in the economy. This is expressed by way of a schedule known as aggregate demand schedule or aggregate schedule. So table 1 shows the relationship between aggregate demand and income. So when income level is 0, aggregate demand is 30, and when income level is 20, aggregate demand to 35, and when income increase to 40, aggregate demand is also equal to 40, and when income is 120, aggregate demand is 60. So the table 1 shows that there is always minimum level of expenditure in the economy even when income level is 0, because a consumer will purchase goods even when his income is 0. He will borrow the money from market or he will use his past savings. So when income is 0, then aggregate demand or planned expenditure will be 30. And the second one is, it is clear from the table that with increase in income, aggregate demand is also increasing. So there is a positive relationship between income and aggregate demand. And the last one is, after a certain level of income is reached, aggregate demands lag behind Y. Thus, when Y means income is equal to 60, aggregate demand is equal to 45. Likewise, when income is 80, aggregate demand is 50. So after a point of time, after a point, then income will be greater than expenditure. Means the consumer will start saving some of the amount of his income. So that is why after a point income starts increasing, then aggregate demand. So figure 1 clearly shows the relation between income and consumption. So on x-axis income is given and on y-axis aggregate demand is given. So initially the income line starts from the point of origin, means expressing the income level is equal to zero, but the consumption line starts from point 30, means when the level of income is zero, there will be a minimum amount of expenditure. The consumer will incur some expenditure to buy goods for their survival, even when the income level is zero. He will borrow the amount from outside, or he will use his past saving. But both these lines cut each other at point E. After that, income is greater than the consumption expenditure. Next is components of aggregate demand. So aggregate demand are discussed with reference to closed economy and open economy. So components of aggregate demand in a closed economy. So a closed economy has two sector closed economy or three sector closed economy. A two sector closed economy include household sector and producer sector. Household purchase goods for the purpose of consumption. Accordingly, their expenditure will be termed as consumption expenditure. Whereas producer purchase goods for the purpose of investment. So their expenditure will be termed as investment expenditure. So in case of two sector closed economy, aggregate demand will always be equal to consumption expenditure plus investment expenditure. But in case of three sector closed economy, government sector is also included. Government makes collective consumption expenditure. It refers to public consumption expenditure or consumption expenditure on behalf of the society as a whole. And also government makes investment expenditure, such as expenditure on roads and bridges. So the total expenditure of the government will include consumption expenditure as well as investment expenditure. So in case of three sector closed economy, aggregate demand will always be equal to household consumption expenditure plus investment expenditure plus government expenditure. Next is components of aggregate demand in an open economy. In case of open economy, there are four sectors. One additional sector is rest of world sector. Rest of world sector generate demand for our goods and services in the term of our export. Thus, exports add to aggregate demand in the domestic economy. But the economy also makes imports from rest of the world. So imports are opposite to exports. While exports increase aggregate demand in the economy, import decrease the economy. So aggregate demand in case of open economy will be household expenditure plus private investment expenditure plus government expenditure plus net export. Net export can be calculated by subtracting imports from exports. So these were the concepts of components of aggregate demand. And the next topic is concept of aggregate supply. Aggregate supply refers to aggregate production as planned by the producers during an accounting year. And we know that production of goods and services means value addition, and value addition means income generation. And according to the concept of national income, value addition and income generation are identical terms. So aggregate supply means flow of income in the economy during an accounting year. So aggregate supply and income are same according to this concept. Next is aggregate schedule. Aggregate supply schedule. Aggregate supply schedule is a table showing the behavior of aggregate supply with response to different levels of income. So table 2 clearly explains the relationship between aggregate supply and aggregate schedule. When the income level is 0, aggregate supply is also 0. And when income level is 20, aggregate supply is also 20. And when aggregate supply income is 60, aggregate supply is also 60. So table 2 clearly shows perfect identity between aggregate supply and aggregate supply and income. So identity between income and aggregate supply shows that the producer in the economy are ready to supply all that they wish to produce. The producer will wish to supply all the thing they produce because there is excess capacity in the economy. Accordingly, whenever there is increase in demand, the producer will respond to it by planning an equal rise in supply. So these were the relations we can extract from the above table. Next is consumption function. So consumption function as we know, household consumption expenditure is an important component of aggregate demand in the economy. It is directly related to level of income. Means higher the level of income, higher will be the consumption, or lower the level of income and lower will be the consumption expenditure. So the relationship between income and consumption is called consumption function. So studying the behavior of consumption with respect to Y, the economist has identified the following points as of central significance. There is always some minimum level of consumption even when income is zero, because for its survival, the consumer will either borrow from outside or will use his past saving. So this is called autonomous consumption. This leads to negative savings. Second is, consumption is positively related to income. Means rise in income causes rise in consumption, or decrease in income causes decrease in income. And the next is, the entire increase in income during a particular period it knows converted into consumption. A part of it is saved as well. Means it is not necessary that the change in income will always be converted into consumption expenditure. So a consumer or a person will save a part of his income. So the rate at which consumption increases often lags behind the rate at which income increases. Means the rate of increase in income will be greater than the rate of increase in consumption. So table 3 shows the consumption function. When income is 0, consumption is 20. When income increases to 50, consumption increases to 60. when income is 100, consumption is also 100. But when income is 150, consumption is also consumption is 140. So it is clear from the table that when consumption is zero, there is will be a minimum level of expenditure. The consumer or the person will borrow from the outside or will use his past savings. Second one is with increase in income, consumption expenditure is also increasing. Means there is a positive relationship between income and consumption. And the last one is the rate at which consumption increases. The rate at which consumption increases is lower than the rate at which Y increases. Thus, income increases each time by 50, but C increases by 40 every time. Means the change in income is more than the change in its consumption expenditure. So this is the diagrammatic presentation of consumption function. So on x-axis income is given and on y-axis consumption is given. Income line starts from origin, means when income is zero, and consumption line starts from point 20, showing when income is zero, there will be a minimum level of expenditure. So at till point B, expenditure is greater than income, showing negative savings. But after that, income is greater than consumption, which shows that now the consumer starts saving some of his income. So these were the conclusions which can be drawn from the table. Next is slope of consumption line or marginal propensity to consume. So slope of consumption line needs some elaboration. It refers to the rate at which C increases in response to a given increase in income. It indicates the proportion of additional income that goes to consumption. It will be termed as marginal propensity to consume. Means it shows the relationship between change in income and change in consumption. So when from the above table, when income increases from 100 to 150 and consumption increases to 100 to 140, so change in income is 50 and change in consumption is 40. So according to the formula of marginal propensity to consume, which is change in consumption over change in Y, that is 40 divided by 50, means every additional rupee of income, 80% is spent as a consumption expenditure. Means the person is saving 20% of his income. He is only spending 80% of what he is generating as his income. Next is average propensity to consume and marginal propensity to consume. Average propensity to consume and marginal propensity to consume are different concepts. Average propensity to consume shows a relationship between total consumption and total income, whereas marginal propensity to consume shows relationship between change in consumption and change in income. So when from the table, average propensity to consume will be 140 divided by 150, but marginal propensity to consume will be 40 divided by 50. So slope of consumption function is indicated by marginal propensity to consume. The next topic is saving function. So we know that income is either consumed or saved. So income will always be equal to consumption and saving. So we have already studied about consumption function. Now we will study about saving function. So the relationship between saving and income is known as saving functions. So table 3 shows the saving function. When income is 0, consumption is 20, and when income is 50, consumption is 60. So the saving will be, because we know that income is equal to consumption plus saving. So in first case 0 minus 20 is equal to minus 20. So there is negative savings. In second case, when income increases, consumption also increases, but now the saving is minus 10. In third case, when income is 30 and consumption is 100, in that case, whatever the person earns, he is spending all money, so saving will be 0. But at last, when his income increases to 150, the consumption expenditure is 140, means now he is saving some part of his income. So it is clear from the table 4 that when income is 0, there is negative saving, because the consumer will consume for its survival. Second is, saving increases as income increases, means there is positive relationship between income and saving. And the last one is, S will always remains low as compared to income, because saving is part of income. So here is the diagrammatic presentation of saving function. So on x-axis, income is given, and on y-axis, saving is given. So saving line starts from negative, indicating that there is no income, but the consumption is there. As the income increases, his savings are also increasing. So S line starts from minus 20. It indicates the value of savings when income is 0. So S line is positively sloping from left to right in upward direction, indicating that there is positive relationship between income and saving. And the last one is, since S line crosses the x-axis when y is 100, it indicates that saving is 0. And when y is 100, so that S is equal to 0. So S is negative when income is less than 100. S is positive when income is greater than 100. So next is slope of saving line. So slope of saving line refers to the rate at which saving increases in response to a given increase in income. It will be termed as marginal propensity to save. Marginal propensity to save studies the relationship between change in saving with relation to change in income. As we have already studied about the marginal propensity to consume, which shows the relationship between change in consumption and change in income. And similarly, marginal propensity to save shows the relationship between change in saving and change in income. So next is average propensity to save and marginal propensity to save. So average propensity to save shows the relationship between total saving and total income, whereas marginal propensity to save shows the relationship between change in saving and change in income. So slope of
saving function is indicated by marginal propensity to save. So these are the consumption and saving function. I hope this is all clear to you. So thank you, students.